Phantasy Star is a science fiction RPG made for the Sega Mark III, also known as the Sega Master System outside of Japan. Released originally in 1987, Phantasy Star was made to compete with the RPG juggernauts of its time, namely Dragon Quest and Final Fantasy, which made their homes on the Famicom in Japan and the NES worldwide. These two titles were renowned for being expansive journeys in deeply immersive worlds, at a time when most games were predominantly straightforward platformers that simply had the player going from point A to point B, all the while emphasizing the action rather than the adventure. Sega, seeing the potential in this new market for their own console, wanted Phantasy Star to stand toe-to-toe with these RPG giants. In order to accomplish that, it had to do something that separated itself from what came before it. When looking at Phantasy Star nowadays to understand what's different about it and why fans hold it near and dear to their hearts, the seemingly obvious answer is that unlike its Tolkien-inspired counterparts, this is a science fiction RPG. Having said that, the game does still feature the genre staple of swords and sorcery. However, it's also filled with futuristic elements such as robots, laser guns, and interplanetary travel. While it's true that this was fairly uncommon in the genre at the time, and is indeed one of the contributing factors that differentiated it from the competition, this is merely a surface-level observation as to what made Phantasy Star its own beast. The truth is that the science fiction angle was more than just flavoring to help it stand out against its contemporaries. It is, in fact, a very clever narrative framework that breathes life into the game's world, one that successfully constructed an experience that was wholly unique to it at the time. It was this framing that made those who enjoyed it back when it came out feel as if they were going on a grand adventure spanning across the solar system, something beyond the 8-bit pixelated video game sitting in their living room. Phantasy Star takes place in the Algol star system, which is comprised of three planets that the player must explore as well as frequently travel to and from on a space shuttle. The first one is Palma, which bears the most resemblance to Earth. The second is Motavia, a scorching desert planet. And the final one is Deserus, which is covered in ice and snow. These three planets are not only visually distinct from one another, but also contain their own towns, dungeons, and secrets to uncover, giving them each their own sense of identity. In a technical sense, these are simply three different overworlds, as opposed to the singular ones found in both Dragon Quest and Final Fantasy. However, framing them specifically as planets is much more important than one might initially assume. Had this game opted for a single overworld, in which all of the contents of the three planets were separated into different continents, it would have ironically made the game feel significantly smaller. This is because even if the actual size of the game, in this hypothetical version, is virtually identical to the original, the conceptual scope, as it were, has significantly shrunk. No longer is Alice and friends going on an epic space quest that spans across the solar system. It's now no different from what it's competing against, losing a piece of that special something that sets it apart. Not to devalue Phantasy Star's other accomplishments, of course, as it was an impressive technical feat for its time, but this method of framing in particular was what gave the game its grand sense of scale, and is one of its crowning achievements. This was also contrasted beautifully with the way battles and dungeons were handled, in that they were done in first person. This not only allowed the player to feel like they were experiencing the world itself by seeing everything on the ground level, it also led to an interesting feeling of juxtaposition whenever the player traveled through space in order to reach the other planets. The progression of seeing what an underground dungeon looks like to then hopping onto a shuttle and flying through space in order to reach the next planet allowed the player to appreciate the immensity of the game world. What makes these complementing design decisions so brilliant is that through these contrasting points of view of the Algol star system, the team was able to craft a sense of scale, not by making a game that was actually any larger than its competitors, but by instead allowing the imaginations of their players to do it for them. This was achieved in large part simply by altering how the player perceives its three main locations. Instead of three continents on the world map, like most other RPGs, it was three entire planets, a detail further emphasized by being able to see said planets at the same eye level as the main characters. Playing Phantasy Star now, it might feel like a quaint, if dated, RPG, but viewing it from this lens, and putting oneself in the mindset of an individual playing it for the first time when it was released, the reverence for this title should be easy to grasp. It wasn't simply yet another RPG aping its medieval brethren. It was a space-faring journey that truly felt as if it was three times bigger than anything else at the time, and all it took was the idea of the world being larger than the one the developers actually created. The core idea of creating something and then allowing the player's imagination to fill in the gaps of the world was something that was used extensively in several PlayStation 1 titles with a technique known as pre-rendered backgrounds. Technically speaking, it was simply character models walking on top of large image and movie files, but when executed correctly, these characters blended in seamlessly as integral parts of their respective locales, creating the illusion of a living, breathing world. To understand how pre-rendered backgrounds convey a similar sense of conceptual grandness, we're going to take a look at Midgar from Final Fantasy VII. This part of the game is roughly 10% of the whole experience, yet despite being a comparatively smaller part of a much bigger game, it manages to persevere in the minds of players several years after the fact. Part of the reason is how effective the game is in conveying how large Midgar itself is, starting with the game's CGI intro. As Aerith comes into view, we're greeted with an intimate look at the street level, only to then move upwards to a bird's eye view. Harkening back to the sense of perspective Phantasy Star achieved by allowing a similarly intimate view of the world to be contrasted with one that shows the location in full view, this does well in portraying Midgar as a grimy, bustling, cyberpunk metropolis that is so huge it requires multiple sectors to house everything in it. Yet surprisingly, not all of those sectors are explorable to the player. This could be seen as detrimental to the idea of conveying the sheer size of Midgar. Yet despite this, as a location, it still feels enormous, and this is due in no small part to the aforementioned pre-rendered backgrounds, further fleshing out the look and feel established by the intro. Take this slum in the early game, for instance. It's technically just one screen. However, it manages to convey so much. We see Tifa's bar, some item shops, and people's homes, all of which is in a sorry state, compounded by the surrounding junk. This not only creates a somewhat melancholic atmosphere, but it gives this single screen a real sense of location due to how much is implied about the slums without feeling the need to actually show it all. It isn't necessary to explore every nook and cranny of every building or to be able to see it from every single angle in order to feel how large and hopeless the slums are. It's already understood based on how the environment is able to convey the information. Much like how Phantasy Star didn't need the player to actually explore an entire planet to feel how big its world is. Despite the methods and scale being different, i.e. framing three overworlds as planets, and using a first-person perspective to show one's place in the world, compared to an image getting across a single location, and using camera techniques to get across a sense of scale, the core concept is the same. Presenting the idea of something, and then allowing the player's minds to create their own interpretation of what that idea is. A fusion of the art and the player coming together to form a unique vision. Nowadays, this method of game design isn't as common. With the increase of budgets and the exponential improvements made to technology over the years, this means that game worlds can be as large and fully explorable as developers want them to be. And while there's absolutely nothing wrong with that, there is something to be learned about this approach, in that not everything needs to be explicitly laid out to the player in order to effectively get something across to them. Part of what makes video games so unique as a medium is that sense of interactivity, both directly and indirectly. Sometimes, letting people's imaginations do the heavy lifting allows for its own unique sense of immersion, one that can't be replicated anywhere else in quite the same way. This has been Daniel, everyone, and I'll see you all again next time.